away for me, please? And we will send out all the notes to you afterwards, okay? Cool. So now this is Mark's first time at Interesting Talks. We've been going back and forth for 2 or 3 years. It's been a long time. We don't know why this hasn't happened before, but it has happened now. So Mark Walsh has dedicated his life to embodied learning. He founded Embodied Facilitator Course, Embodied Yoga Principles, and Integration Training. He has taught in nearly 30 countries and made the embodiment available online through a YouTube channel that's gained over 13 million hits, and recently he's also started the Embodiment Podcast. His clients include Unilever, L'Oreal, Virgin Atlantic, Shell, the House of Lords, and now Interesting Talks. Crown the jewel, crown the jewel. He's come all the way from Brighton to speak for you this evening, so please give a very warm London welcome to Mr. Mark Walsh.
Look at my notes, and right here it said, tell joke. And, you know, I'd just like to thank Past Mark for the specificity of tell joke, so thank you, Past Mark. That was a problem for a future Homer, if you know that sketch. Okay, what are we doing? The body. So this talk is about why the body matters. So this talk is about why the body is much more than most people think, and why disconnection from the body, put bluntly, is killing us. So that is the focus of this talk. A few warnings. There'll be bad jokes, probably quite a lot of swearing. If you're easily offended, I would sneak out. This would be the time to sneak out. I'd also just want to bring your attention to how you are. Yeah, to how you are. So in a talk, there's two things going on. There's speaking and listening, right? And so you're a good half of that. Like, notice how you are today. So actually, let's get a bit of a read on that. Energy levels. So this is like loads and loads of energy, like I've had too much coffee. I feel a bit like that now until I relax and connect a bit more with you guys. And this is like, I'm absolutely exhausted. And this is, I'm British and I'm just gonna do the middle thing because that's safe. So just, and thumbs up, especially if you're German. Okay, so, yeah, okay. So where are you energy-wise? Okay, this is like loads of energy. This is like no energy at all. I'm genuinely asking, it does affect what I will say. This is interactive. So again, if you're English and you find interactive things difficult, then you may be a little embarrassed, so you won't be forced to. So that's good. Things about you. Who is like a trainer or coach or something like what I do? I heard there's quite a lot of you around, or a consultant, or a learning synergizer, or whatever pretentious names we have now. Great, who has a real job? Education, just give me a sense of what you do. Education, like teachers and stuff. Okay, healthcare, doctors, nurses, heroes of the UK. No? Transport. Financial sector. I love you too. I do love you too. Other things, just shout out what you do. So I want to actually make this useful for you so I don't waste your life, because you're going to be 2 hours closer to your death by the end of this talk. Oh, I should also warn you, if you're a millennial, trigger warning. There's going to be sort of upsetting and difficult things in this talk, as well as fun things. So if you're sort of thinking, difficult things like suicide and alcoholism and death, if that scares me, then maybe sneak out and just get drunk downstairs. That's it. Adoption. What do you do? Shout out. What do you do?
IT.
HR.
TV producer.
TV producer.
Recruitment.
Analyst.
Fundraising.
Not in the street, you're one of those people that crash
through.
Lawyer. I have actually talked to my lawyer because I'm about to share a story of how I used to deal drugs. And I actually talked to my lawyer beforehand, and she says the police rarely prosecute for crimes in the past. So as long as I'm not too specific, I'm apparently okay. So it's good to have a friendly lawyer on your side. Okay, where are you from? So generally British of some kind. Okay, a few people saying actually Scottish, that or Welsh. All right, France, Germany, United States, Japan, China, somewhere in Africa. South America. Right, we're going to look at culture today, so this is relevant to have some sense. Usually in London, the groups are pretty mixed. That's the sense I got from the accents beforehand. All right, what else? Practices. So this is about the body. Some of you probably already do some body stuff. Who has a body? Just show hands. No disembodied ghosts in the room. Okay, so it's kind of relevant to everyone to look at the body, yeah? Who would say, I am a body? Not just I have a body, or I am a body, or if we more... the body is an aspect of who I am. Would anyone kind of sign up for that? Okay. That's basically the basis of this talk. You can go get drunk now. That's it. Pretty much done it. What else? Who does yoga?
Who does what?
Yoga.
I used to do yoga.
Okay? And just not you tried it once at a party when you're drunk, but that you generally do. Martial arts? Martial artists? Yeah, one in front. Great, it's always good to know where they are, so who not to start fight with. Dancers? Dance people? Great. So it's quite a lot of sort of body experience in the room, so I'll try and link to some of those. I could keep going, there's other body things, but there's a few. It says here, check they're not cynical London wankers. So what I would say there, though, is just be open. So what I found in talks, sometimes people have their arms crossed and they'll come in and they'll be like, I know everything already. And I'll be like, okay, then I'm wasting your time and mine. Does that make sense? Yeah. So how would you sit right now if you wanted to get the most from this talk? Like, so while I'm getting a sip of water, you could change how you're sitting or use this as a chance to run out. How would you sit? If that question makes no sense, it will by the end of this talk. Yeah, if it's just like, well, you know, I'm just sitting, then just you know, so I don't fall off the chair, then we'll get more into that.
I'm trying to stop this chair from
creaking. It does sound a bit dodgy, doesn't it? If that was coming through the wall, you'd have an image of what was happening there. Yeah. If English is your second language, I probably am speaking too quickly for you because I'm excited. So if English is your second language, your third or fourth, do this symbol, and that means please slow down. If you do that before you're pissed off, okay, then it won't be like, you know? I do appreciate that because I speak only very bad French and Russian, so your English is almost certainly better than my whatever you speak. So any Russian speakers here?
Yeah.
Great. I'm like flirting in Russian. Okay, stories. You're supposed to do stories of these talks. I looked up on the internet, it said tell stories. So the first half is mostly going to be a sort of story about my life, but illustrating things from this world of embodiment, which I'll come on to, that's our main topic for today. The second half, after the break, that's going to be the interactive bit, mostly, though I'm going to hopefully keep you engaged, but there'll be, after the break, we're going to be doing quite a lot more activities and exercises, and before it, just you can sort of chill out and let your dinner settle if you just had that. Okay, so I grew up in the Fens, which is, if you're not from the UK, it's like an inbred rural part of the country, a lot like Alabama or somewhere like that, with the American comparison. And I grew up in a normal family, and by normal I mean riddled with alcoholism, suicide, mental ill health, drug addiction, just your sort of standard British family, really. It gets worse. I had a cousin who killed himself, and I was actually raised with him. He was kind of my hero growing up. And I was raised with him because my aunt, his mother, killed herself. She was a schizophrenic. And right now, at least three members of my immediate family are on antidepressant medication. Okay, so I've always had this sense I was born with kind of a gun to my head. Yeah, I was born with a head, actually, is the key thing here. Born with a choice, as it were. Yeah. Difficult things growing up, and you know, my dad was an alcoholic and he tried to kill himself twice as well. I'll come back to those happy stories later. This was just the environment I grew up in, so that is part of the story here. And the exceptional thing about me was that I was very clever as a child. I was super bright, I had an IQ in the top 0.01%. So if someone wants to do the maths, that's pretty bright. Notice, it's sort of socially unacceptable to say you're clever, isn't it? You might be thinking, how boastful, what an arrogant young man, he'd probably be at least half right. But that's actually quite interesting, that it's something so important to be cognitively intelligent that we can't say it. Yeah. 10 years of alcoholism, however, after that I'm sort of more medium intelligence now. Which is quite fun doing a talk in the pub, actually, for recovering alcoholic. So I was super clever, and everyone was telling me I was clever. School was super easy for me. I used to sneak Camus and Nietzsche into class as a child just to have something interesting to do. And you know, in exams I used to sniff poppers just to make it more challenging. Do you know what poppers are? It's a solvent abuse, basically, just to make the exam more interesting because it was harder to do well fucked up on solvents. So that was my kind of childhood, and I was told, so I come from a family of teachers as well as mad people, and they told me that what mattered was education, learning. My house was full of books. By 16, I actually read all the books in school, and they were getting new books in from Cambridge University. Yeah, and Cambridge. And I was told, book learning is what matters. Does that make sense to you? This is basically the implicit story of all of Western culture, But what matters is book learning and being clever cognitively. At 14, however, I took quite large quantities of psychedelic drugs and had a sense that there might be something more to life after that. That experience was like, wow, I'm not being told the entire truth by my culture, by my education. At 16, I fell in love with a beautiful, long, dark-haired girl called Sally. She's a lovely girl, still a friend. And my first sexual experiences were essentially mystical experiences. So my first orgasm with a woman, I had blinding white light, I couldn't see. And I had this sense that the sort of I was one with her and she was one with me. Has anyone had really good sex like that? It sort of accidentally happened at 16 and I couldn't make it happen until quite a few years afterwards on purpose. But I had this opening that I was sort of one with the universe, they call it an oceanic experience. Yeah, so through drugs, through these fortuitous love and sexual experiences, I went, hang on a minute, this doesn't seem to be something you can learn from a book. Does that make sense? I went, something's going on here. The difficulty with state experiences, strong state experiences like those, whether they be accidental or drug-induced or whatever, is that you come down from them. Yeah, you don't have, as a sort of teenage boy with very low emotional intelligence, I didn't have any framework for that. Yeah, and by 17, I was pretty in a bad way. I'd say physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually bankrupt. I was seriously alcoholic and drug addicted by that point. I was selling drugs. This is the bit that I checked with my lawyers. I can say that apparently. I was also just suicidal, and I was thinking, well, my cousin killed himself. Maybe that's the way to go. You know, I guess now I'd say clinically depressed. And I'd wrecked that first love relationship because I had no idea how to run a relationship because there wasn't really a book on that. And if there was a book, it wouldn't have helped. You with me? Anyone else here cock up their first love relationship, Miley? Some of you did pretty well then, okay, great. So that was my experience. I was 17 and everyone was telling me, you're really clever. You're really clever, they were telling me. You're going to go far. You know, to university, you're going to go far. And I was thinking, if I'm so clever, why am I so fucked up? Right? If I'm so clever, why am I suicidally miserable? Why am I alcoholic? Why did I ruin my first relationship? If I'm so bright, that doesn't really make sense to me. And I kind of accidentally discovered that two things. One, there's more than one way to be smart. Yeah, there's more than one way to be smart. We might say emotional, you know, multiple intelligence, which might be the term for that. The second thing I discovered was that disconnection kills. Disconnection kills. So disconnection from self, others, planet, spirit, there's various levels of that, but the disconnection kills. So in a way, this talk is about how talk is cheap. Yeah? This is like the book on why books are a waste of time. Okay, not entirely, but certainly limited or perhaps overprivileged in our culture, would be one way, another way to put it. So a talk on why you shouldn't listen to talks. Yeah, it's a wonder I haven't been booked for a TED talk with that as my sort of
Shouldn't listen to a talk.
So it doesn't leave a lot. Well, what does it leave might be the question. So for example, right now, experience, how are you? This is this question we ask I've been around the world teaching and everywhere I go, they ask this question, how are you? If you actually look at that question, it's fascinating. What is the manner of your being? Yeah. What is the way in which you are being? That's quite a fact, that's an ontological question, to use a long word. The idea I would say is that Wikipedia hasn't solved the world's problems. Like, you can get your phones out and you can have all the information of the world available to you, which is fucking mental. That's like Star Trek, isn't it? You know, anyone over 30 here, it's like, wow, I hope you still have that amazement. It's brilliant in many ways, but it hasn't, you know, we still live in the most drug addicted, suicidal, and mentally ill culture that's, I think, ever been recorded, according to some anthropologists. So that's pretty serious, despite the magnificence of our culture in other ways. It's like if someone said to you, I've read a lot of good books on kissing. Would that person be an expert lover? Yeah. Or do you want to lift in my car? I've looked at a lot of websites about driving. You might be a little sceptical of that person, might be not. So you actually kind of already know this, I'm not telling you anything that isn't intuitive and obvious. So hello, I feel a bit more here now, and a bit less nervous. It's nice to see the smiles on the back, I do appreciate that welcome. So we're in this together, that's another sort of key message here, is we're in this and this, yeah, together. breathe out. Okay, so my story is really one of failure. I'm telling you about my own personal story of failure, which is indicative of the failure of Western civilization. So in some ways, the story I've just told you of my own personal failure by 17 years old is really just a microcosm of the failure of Western civilization in terms of health, in terms of well-being, in terms of wisdom, in terms of interpersonal relationships, and other ways. What else? University. So everyone said, you're clever, you should go to university. So I crawled into university, because by this point I was in a pretty bad way. I crawled there, and I knew deep inside that I needed something that wasn't to be found in the library, the university. I didn't actually go in the library for the first term. And I walked into a martial arts dojo. A dojo is like a gym, a practice hall, a place of the way, technically. And the reason I did that is because I was selling lots of drugs, and I thought I'd just move from the countryside to the big city, and that things step up a gear in the big city, let's just say. There were some very practical reasons to be learning martial arts. And I walked into this martial arts dojo thinking, this will be good for business, this will be practical. And actually, something just immediately spoke to me, it called me. It said, you need this. It said, slap, slap, listen up, you fucking need this, pay attention. It's that like that feeling of sort of really being loved, when you know you love someone, you haven't worked it out on an Excel spreadsheet. Yeah, that's not how people do dating. Hayley Quinton next week, she's brilliant, by the way. She'll probably talk about some similar things. It's not something you can work out intellectually. Yeah, it's that gut feeling of being in love. Who here has had a gut feeling of being in love? Okay, so I hope most of you, yeah? So you all know this already. I'm just making it more explicit and obvious. So I walked in and it's like, Aikido is beautiful. If you've not seen Aikido, it's like just beautiful circular movements, like two people doing Tai Chi quickly, and hello Joanna, and one of them is someone I know, that's nice, and someone then rolling away at the end, yeah, rolling away at the end. It's just this beautiful art, and it's non-violent. It's a non-violent martial art. It's kind of a contradiction. And something in me just went, you need that, and I just dedicated myself to it at university. And it was quickly apparent to me that I could learn more about myself in a martial arts dojo than I could from my psychology course that I was sort of doing on the side of all the martial arts I was really doing. Yeah. For example, when I was stressed, is it having a theory on stress that helps, or is it the breathing exercise that I just learned in Aikido the day before? Yeah. It became very obvious to me that one was more practical than the other. And while theory can be useful, certainly the practice was the key thing. So this applies to anything in your life. Like, it's like, yes, theory, yes, look at the websites or listen to experts and speakers, but what are you actually doing? What is your practice? What is your way of changing how you are, to come back to that very simple question? So after university, there was a careers fair, and I walked around and there was all these sort of disembodied people in suits trying to tell me to come to this company or that company. And that was my first kind of hit of the world of work, the kind of corporate world of legal work anyway. And it left me cold. My experience of the careers fair was just like, why would I do that with my life? Like, why would I give you my heart and soul so you can put it in this weird plastic form? I actually cried, actually left in tears. The careers fair just going, I don't know what I'm gonna do with my life, because this is what I was told was jobs, was work, and you had to get a job right after university. So I thought, well, what am I gonna do? Because I just intuitively don't wanna do that. I didn't feel right. I was getting in touch with my own intuitive sense. If you're looking for purpose, if you're looking for work that you love, by the way, that bodily sense, like being in love, is really important. Because that's your radar. That's what tells you, fuck no, or hell yeah. Make sense?
Yes.
Yeah, that sense of like, yes, this, not this, or this, not quite this. Yeah, that subtle sense. So I just decided to do lots of martial arts. I thought, fuck it, I don't know what I'm doing, so I did lots of martial arts. I went to around the world in different martial arts dojos and schools. There's one particularly in the exotic, in the Black Country in the West Midlands. I'm sorry it wasn't in Tibet or somewhere exotic like that, Japan or somewhere. It was in the West Midlands, and I did go to other places, but that was the sort of best school in the country for odd reasons. And it was a very sort of hard traditional training, sort of Mr. Miyagi style. And my dojo mate was a guy called Polish Pete, and he didn't really speak English at the time, but we became very good friends because we were training together, suffering together, eating together, and Polish Pete was great. Eventually he started to learn some English and he would say things like, it's a Polish embodiment, Polish man embodiment, I say three Poles here, aren't they? And he'd say things like, in my country, you would die in the snow. And he'd just walk up. And I'd be like, wow, that's an entirely different way of being, you know? So I'd travel a bit up to that point, but as I started traveling more and meeting different people from different cultures and noticing they had a different way of being. Not every Polish man is like that, but quite a few are. What else? So I've actually ended up being the best man at his wedding in Poland, and again, I didn't speak a word of English, of Polish, sort of Czech, and that was about it, anywhere. I was able to just have a really good time with all his friends and family in the mountains south of Krakow at this wedding. I was the best man, I sort of stumbled through this weird Catholic thing. My family are Irish Catholic, so I sort of understood what was going on. And the benefits of Latin. But anyway, and I've made friends with all these people, and it's beautiful. And Kasia, his beautiful, gentle wife, was there, and she would sort of hug me and love me. And I thought, wow, this is wonderful. There's a way of connecting which goes beyond words. Makes sense? There's a reason we dance together and have sex, isn't there? Yeah? That the bodily connection still really matters, even in 2018, when we can, you know, text each other and do all that other good stuff that we do, Facebook or whatever. So I realised that bodily connection was really where it was at, having that experience with those Polish people. And you know, now I work with translators. For example, I work in Russia a lot and have translators. And it's really interesting because now you think you're listening to my words, perhaps, and maybe you are, but you're also listening to my body and my being. Yeah, and I know this because when I'm teaching in Russia and I make a joke, everyone laughs before the translation. And I go, okay, well, what was that? Because unless Russians are young, most older Russians don't speak any English. It's quite rare. So it's something that's come across. Make sense? Yeah? What else? Oh, another little example. That looks like. Okay, everyone, touch your knees. Touch your knees. Go. Touch your knees. Yeah, whose first instinct was to touch their elbows?
Yeah.
Yeah? Most of you either did it or you went to do it and then you went, no, I'm very clever. You're not catching me up. You're trembling. Yes. Yes. So you probably understand the words, but you're listening to the body. We're going to come into a bit more about how it's more than body language later. But so your communication, no matter what you're involved with, is through the body. Yeah. So that was the kind of thing I was discovering when it was a lot more than just fighting. So the martial arts, I was learning about myself, I was learning about culture, communication, and I thought, this is really interesting to me. Yeah. Okay, Aikido, the martial arts, opened up into other things. So I started dancing tango, you know? It's like, you can learn one thing from Aikido, but you'll learn different things in tango. It's just different embodied arts. I started doing yoga, lots of yoga, emotional intelligence type work, free dance, anyone do five rhythms? Any crazy five rhythms hippies here? Okay, lots of good five rhythms in London. What else? Body therapy, improv comedy, body work, different body work traditions like Feldenkrais, Alexander technique. So, what I'm mapping for you here is the main influences on this field that's now called embodiment, body intelligence, or somatics. It hasn't quite got a proper name yet. Embodiment seems to be coalescing as the name for the how all these things come together. Yeah, so I've been studying a lot of them. Some I know quite a lot about, some just a little bit about. And there's lots of them, and it's cool because they're pretty available now. Yeah. Okay, what else? Peace building, yeah. So, I was doing the Aikido, and that was cool, throwing people around and putting them in arm locks and things like that, getting beaten up 24 hours a day with Polish Pete. And I started thinking, though, maybe this could be used for something better, for something bigger. And I looked out there, and I found this cool organisation called Aiki Extensions, and they do Aikido off the mat, they call it. And they're involved in educational projects, therapeutic projects, and peace projects. So I got involved with one in Cyprus with the United Nations. I don't know if you know, in Cyprus, it's like a divided country, and there's like what's called the Green Line, which is the UN no man's land in the middle. And we actually did a project right in the middle of this no man's land, where there's like minefields and rocket scarred kind of buildings. And we brought together people from war-torn countries, so it was Greeks and Turks, there was, I don't know, Brits and Iraqis, there was Israelis and Palestinians, Americans, and everyone. Yeah. So there was all these people from these countries that have been at war that hated each other. And we brought them together to do martial arts together. And that sounds like a terrible idea, doesn't it? Sounds like a really bad idea. And people on the first day were saying things like, I've been taught my whole life to hate you. That was like an opening for a conversation on the first day. Yeah. And then people started saying things like, I've been taught to hate you, but I want to listen to you. How do I do that? Or they say things like, you know what, we trained together and we sweated together and it was hard together and maybe let's eat together. Make sense? I've got shivers up my spine. This was like 12 years ago. Shivers up my spine just actually thinking about this still. And actually we formed a really good group of people that then went on to do various projects together and various other things. And that was the first time I realized that body could be used for profound things. Yeah, not just for a bit of fun or, you know, wisdom in the body. Well, that's nice. Sounds hippie, doesn't it? But this was some serious shit. I also saw what I now call... No one made a phone call about a drug dealer, did they? It's a pretty good joke, come on. So I also saw what I now call embodied leadership. So I saw some really good leaders in that project. There's a guy called Don Levine, a guy called Richard Strozzi Heckler, both of them became mentors eventually. And they had a presence to them, a leadership presence. You've probably seen people with this in your life. A certain oomph, we might think of it as charisma or gravitas. And I saw them and I went, they've got something that I don't have and I want that, what is that? And I realized it was to do with how they moved. So not so much their body language, but their body being a bit deeper than body language. I also started seeing the kind of cultural body. I had the extension sent me around the world. I spent about 3 years working in war zones, essentially, and various kind of conflicted places doing projects with the body, and this embodied peace building is called. And I started seeing different bodies, different cultural bodies. So for example, I lived in the slums of Brazil, which is one of the most violent places I lived, actually. Anyone Brazilian there? So I lived in the slums of Brazil, and it was pretty rough. And I also lived above a nightclub, and I was still a young man. I was just sort of getting drunk and having lots of dates and dancing and doing lots of martial arts and working in the favelas, the slums, the favelas they're called. And my mum came over for Christmas, and I said, you can't stay here, it's really dangerous. And she said, okay, let's, you know, go somewhere nice. So I was with my girlfriend, Veronica, beautiful Brazilian girl. And, you know, I was like, da-da-da, and my mum was just looking at me. She was like, where did you get those hips? Because I was moving differently. My way of being was starting to alter from being in that cultural soup. And for those of you who have come from other countries to England, you may find yourself anglicising, is that a word? Becoming a bit more British. You know, I have my Irish side and my English side. Now, as some of you are like, it's a stereotype. It's like, well, yeah, kind of, though not everyone's the same because we're different personalities. And culture exists through the body. So that was one of the things I was discovering. And, you know, I remember I was with Veronica, my girlfriend there, and we've stopped for lunch, and she's eating a mango, and she's just like, oh, the juice is just like running down her full Brazilian breast. And it's really let me have my happy memory. And I'm sort of embarrassed. I've never been so English. I'm sort of like, my mum's there, you know? And my mum's like, oh. And I realized that ability to really enjoy oneself is not something we're culturally taught in the UK so much. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If, by the way, if you want to try that, just tilt your head back a little bit, put your heart up a little bit, open your mouth, roll your eyes, and just say, oh. Still a bit English, okay. Can we try one more, if you're willing. You don't have to, but if you're willing. So what you do is you open your mouth wide, put your head back and say, oh. Yeah, some people are like, oh. Okay. I applaud your effort. So there's that's form for my friend Dylan Newcomb. It's a particular form for a particular embodiment system, but that's what she was embodying in that moment. And I went, that's interesting, I don't do that very well. Yeah, now I do it much better. And that's just one little piece that I'm getting. It's a sort of fun piece. Okay, what else? War zones, yes. So I also saw the effects of trauma on the body. Yeah, so when I was in Afghanistan, for example, I feel it in my body actually, even just saying it. Someone said to me in Afghanistan, because they've been at war for a long time, someone said to me there, said, people get so angry so quickly now. They get angry so quickly. Now that's a physiological thing. Yeah. So one of the effects of trauma could be what's called hyperarousal hyperstimulation. If you imagine having a few espressos as soon as you wake up, that feeling of, oh, I've got to do something, I've got to go somewhere, adrenaline, rather than that like deep relaxation you may have. I get that a little bit in London, just from the speed of London compared to Brighton, it's like an adrenaline shot. And I've certainly come across that in Israel where I've worked a lot, that quickness you'll see in Israel. Yeah. Other times you see numbing. So you might see in Russia, Russian smile. Yeah. You might see this sort of armoring, it's called, where the body gets chronically tense. Okay, or in the eyes, the thousand yard stare, the chronic tension in the eyes. That's something. And all in people's reactions, like in kids in slums of Brazil, if I say touch their shoulder, like you would just to call someone's attention, they might suddenly turn around defensively. Yeah? Or they might just do nothing. That's actually scarier. Yeah, learn helplessness. So the lack of tone or the excess tone in the body is one of the things you'll see in traumatized bodies. It's quite easy to spot kids that have been abused, actually, because they often have one of these, this boundary issue. Now, put that into interpersonal relationships. How you do boundaries, okay? Yeah, so like, for example, I've dated quite a lot in Russia and Ukraine where there's a lot of trauma. The if you don't know like World War II history, it's, and Stalin afterwards, it's pretty heavy. Yeah, it's pretty heavy. Like, Ukraine has had, like, in the last 100 years, three, like, massive famines that wiped out millions of people who weren't really famines, they were genocide, yeah? And it's in people's system, and to date in that environment is quite interesting. So, for when I ask a girl out in Ukraine, for example, she might be like, why are you talking to me? Yeah? Or equally the passivity again, well, just going along with things, which isn't so good either, right? Okay? So that trauma plays out interpersonally in terms of how we do boundaries, how we, the trauma and intimacy don't really go together. Yeah? So intimacy can be a great healer for trauma, actually. I've certainly had a lot of my trauma from working in war zones healed through love and intimate relationships and feeling safe and feeling held and that kind of nice feeling in the body. But equally, trauma can get in the way of intimacy. Yeah? If you've got that everything numb, how can you feel? So you numb the pain, but you're also numbing the good emotions too. You're numbing the ability to connect. So the traumatized body is one that I've come across, though I shouldn't complain too much about war zones. I did meet my wife in the Ukraine. It was a bit of a setup. My psychologist contact there, when the war started with Russia, which is still going on, by the way, an undeclared war in the eastern Ukraine, my contact there said, look, we can't really pay you very much anymore because the economy's collapsed because of this war. And they weren't paying me that much anyway because the economic strength of the place. And I said, okay, well, I'll do this one thing where I do this trauma event for these therapists, because a lot of the Ukrainians weren't very well versed at that time in trauma, and they were having all these soldiers come to them. And actually, it's very beautiful working with soldiers. Sometimes I just talk through the symptoms of trauma, and you see the soldiers light up, and their eyes say, oh, I'm not just completely insane. And they say, you wouldn't understand. And I say, actually, I would. I spent a number of years in this environment. So I've had bad things happen to me. And you see them light up when they get the sense of like, oh, my response to my wife, maybe their sex life has entirely disappeared, or maybe they're unable to play with their children, isn't just them being freak. And they realize that these embodied responses are actually something that happens cross-culturally, across the board. It happens to a dog, actually. A dog will have traumatic responses. Or you see a dog that's been hit too much, it's just like a soldier. Yeah, jumpy or numb, yeah. Anyway, so I'm in Ukraine to work with therapists working with these guys, and they set me up, basically. They said, here's your new translator, and it's beautiful, beautiful Ukrainian girl. And I don't want to insult any English girls here, but East European girls, a little bit down. Anyway, so they introduced me to her, and she says, look, I'm not a professional translator, but I've been told I have to be here, and my friend Oksana wants to be here. And we got really close. Translating is another example of embodiment, in that, you know, she's next to me for a week, and in that week, I tell her, can you tune into me, not just what I'm saying? Because if I say, da-da-da-da-da, and she says, da-da-da-da-da, that totally destroys the message, doesn't it? Totally destroys the emotional impact. So she's really, you know, she's a trained in various therapies and things, and she's sort of doing her best to tune into me. And by the end of the week, we're just like super bonded. Yeah. So anyway, now we're happily married after some visa shenanigans. And the power of embodiment once again. So yes, you can't sleep with your students, but translators are fine. What else? Sometimes I do see the power of embodiment in very touching ways. So for example, I teach some of embodied yoga principles. If you're a yogi, grab a fly by that afterwards. It's a way of doing yoga that focuses on how we are as people rather than stretches or Instagram handstands. And I had someone doing this in a workshop, and they did this workshop just for a few hours, and we were doing boundaries. We have a no posture, but some people are a little bit, some people are a bit over no. And we have people that healthy, strong sense of no, and we find that in the body, because again, the book isn't gonna help. I mean, can you all say the word no?
No.
So you can all do it, but who here has problems saying no at times? Just put your hand up if you have problems saying no. Okay, about half of you, right? That's slightly gendered as well, and slightly cultured. So English women often struggle with that, particularly English middle-aged women, in my experience. So that ability to hold a boundary, to say no, which is so important for relationships, for sexuality, for work, so not you don't get everyone else's work to do, for so many things, that's an embodied capacity. It's not that you can't say the word, it's that way of being is not habitual for you. Okay, that's not your more habitual yes. Other people need to work on their yes and their no is fine. Yeah, makes sense? You're probably now thinking, which is more me, am I more a yes or a no? And if you're thinking, it depends, then that's a no, you awkward bugger. Though you are right, it does depend on the situation and the, you know, the environment and all the rest of it. If we're in Hawaii, it kind of suggests a yes, doesn't it? Central London suggests a no. Yeah. Anyway, so I taught this woman, this young woman, this no posture, and she looked really touched. And I said, oh, you like that? She said, oh, yeah. I said, oh, great. And then and in a couple of weeks, she went off, didn't know any wise. 2 weeks later, I got an email. She said, I just left my abusive husband. I took my kids with me, and I left. And for years, I've been putting up with violence and emotional abuse and crap from him. Thank you so much. I just needed to find that in my system. And I was, again, shivers now, 2 years later. Like, just absolutely touched by that. She just needed to find that no in her body. Yeah? It's starting to make sense now? It's my rambling story starting to paint a picture of what embodiment might be. In the business world as well, so I've been working in the business world for the last 10 years, which coming out of the humanitarian world originally was weird because it's like a different language. I had to buy a suit and nice shoes, and no shoes today, but anyway. I had to, you know, learn that language, and what I realized was it actually felt exactly like a war zone. So when I started working in business, it was really familiar. I was like, oh, it's just a war zone. Just no one's killing each other. They're just firing each other. Right? It was the same energy. It was the same feeling. I was quite at home there. So I worked with various corporate clients and things like embodied leadership. Because again, if somebody has, maybe they've got an MBA. Maybe they've read all the theories about leadership. But they come in and they're like, hello, welcome to this year's motivational meeting. I'm John. Here's interesting talks. Hello. They haven't got that vibrance and that dynamism and that life, not as an act, because I'm not like sitting here thinking, oh, I should move my hands like a politician. I'm just alive. I'm just in my body. And that's compelling, isn't it? Right? Like someone that has that. It's also sexy. Who's single? Put your hands up. It's not for me. Just put your hands up. Put your hands right up. Have a little look around. Have a little look around. I want everyone to get laid, not just me. So I'm in the break, you know who you haven't dreamed of. Okay, that was just for you, that has nothing to do with the talk at all. No, so embodiment can make us more charismatic, it can make us more attractive. This, but you know this, like it's why kids are fascinating. If you see a kid, now you might find kids annoying too, but they are interesting. Kids have life, they have vibrancy, you know what I mean? Like there's something about them that you go, yeah! Yeah, kids always find me at parties and weddings, they want to play with me, and they look at me, they're like, you're going to play with me, aren't you? I'm like, yes! Oh, I was checking out that girl, and I have to play with you! Yeah? Because they see that vibrancy. Okay, if you're willing to get on the floor and play with kids, they can feel that. There's something they like particularly. If you're a mixture of warm but dominant, they really like it. It's like dogs. Dogs and kids like that. It's like, I'm the boss, but I'm going to be nice to you. Yeah, that's a particular embodiment that kids and dogs like. I was teaching in Russia one time, this dog starts barking at me. Wah, 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 a big dog in the forest. We're off doing some hippie shit in the forest. And this dog comes along, and everyone's like, oh my God, you know, because it's a bit of rabies or something, he's in the countryside. And I was like, good dog, I like dogs, you're a nice dog, good doggy. And everybody and then the dog sort of just starts being friendly and rolls over, and I'm tickling its tummy. And everyone goes, oh my God, the dog speaks English. This is astounding. And it's like, no, the dog doesn't fucking speak English, the dog speaks body. And you do too. Yeah? And you're an animal. You've got this other, you know, prefrontal cortex slapped and slightly wired in on top of that. That's worth acknowledging. However, you still have that mammalian biology. Okay, and a lot of your reaction tonight is gonna come from your embodiment and how that interfaces with mine. Yeah? So you know that I could be the best speaker in the world and some of you would still fucking hate me. Just because I have an embodiment that you don't like or reminds you of someone or just you're in a grumpy mood today. And I don't know about you, but when I'm in a grumpy mood, everyone is wrong. Does that make sense? Because it's my mood, that's the lens. Or if I'm on holiday,
It's like, it's lovely here, everyone's so friendly. Everyone's such a great place, the food's amazing. And it's like, well, yeah, but also I'm relaxed and I'm put in a good mood. So my perception is changing. Perception and thinking are embodied. You know this. This is common sense. I might pull out some studies later on if you need some science behind that. So business life, I think right now in the business world, everything's so stressed. In the 10 years I've been working with companies, people are moving so quick. I've been in stress management courses for at least 10 years. And have you seen this? It's just getting insane. The speed, the complexity, the fullness of people's calendars and lives is just coming to a point, and it's difficult to feel at speed. Yeah, now if you're a martial artist, you can be trained to do that, but generally a lot of embodied training is quite slow at first, like meditation and yoga and things like Tai Chi, because at first it takes a little while to tune in. And here's the really scary thing: if you're moving so quickly that you're not feeling, you're a psychopath. You literally are. You've all rushed and been on the tube. I imagine you have. You've rushed, you've got down my way, and at that point, people don't matter. People are objects at that point. People are not subjects. Yeah? People are just thinking, you're nodding, right? I'm not the only one that's got that tendency. When you're in a rush, same as when you're hangry and you haven't eaten, maybe, and your biology's a bit skew-whiffed, okay, there's various other reasons for that. Other people become things and not people. That's horrifying. Think about what that means. Yeah, they stop being subjects, they stop being human beings. So embodiment to me is really just about being a human being. It's a study of being a human being and staying human for as long as possible. Because under enough stress, we say act like an animal, you might say. We become meaner, we become stupider, we become less creative, which isn't so useful in most modern workplaces when everything's changing as well. Yeah? So this fight flight can kick in. And the discipline, we stop feeling ourselves, we can't feel other people. That's the key thing here. One of the key messages from this talk. When we can't feel ourselves, we can't feel others. Yeah, and that's terrifying. A few experiments. This is ethics. I studied ethics at university level, and no one talked about the body. There's all these theories from Kant and, you know, Hume and all this. It's like, what about the body? Actually, ethics, morals, you could say values, is built into your system. Yeah, you can prove this very easily. Put your hand up, interactive. Stop texting your mum. Okay, and now imagine a fluffy kitten or adorable animal if you're allergic to kittens, any adorable animals, like kitten, rabbit. Okay, on your hand, can you all see, you've got the kitten, look at the kitten, love the kitten. Everyone got the kitten. Good. Little nose. Now strangle it to death. Okay, what just happened in your body? What did you just do in your body? Who contracted in some way in their body? Good. Okay. That means, I mean, you might not have done, you might have missed it, it might have happened quickly, maybe you weren't really visualizing the kids. It doesn't mean you're a psychopath if you didn't. However, most of you had some sense of contraction in the body because you're not evil kitten killing people. Right? Because you're feeling your, and that ability to feel when something is off is how, is one of the ways I should say that we keep ethical. Is we go, that doesn't feel right. It's the same when you tell a lie. Jordan Peterson, some of you may know, says when you tell a lie, you become weaker. I can actually prove that. You become physically weaker. We might do this afterwards as an experiment. You become physically weaker when you tell a lie. You can feel it in your posture, the contraction, the wobbling, the smallifying sometimes happens. This is sort of like guilt and shame if you've drunk too much. There's that sort of twist and contraction. Oh, what did I do last night? Yeah. 10 years of alcoholism. It's fascinating. Okay, so morality, ethics is built into the body. And this happens, for example, when I was doing with a major, major big company, I won't say which one, a big one, like one of the biggest ones, and I did an embodied leadership session with them, and in the afternoon I hung out with them, and I said, okay, do you mind if I just hang out for a little while and see what you guys do? And they're like, no, you sit on our board meeting, it was like high end, they're talking about how many factories in China to close and things like that, right? And they started talking about diversity, they started talking about environmental policy, they started talking about work-life balance. And afterwards I said, you guys are kind of a bunch of hippies, you know, like, do you normally talk about that stuff? And they said, no, we don't normally talk about it, but today it felt meaningful. Yeah? I think that's probably not a coincidence that I'd spend the whole time with them in their bodies. 5 minutes before the break, yeah? Okay, good. Where was I? I get passionate about this stuff, getting into a kind of flow. Yeah, so the subjective sense of the body, that's what we're talking about here. That's what we're going to do some experiments with after break. How you are is the simplest definition of embodiment. The body is the kind of not just meat, not just brain taxi, as Francis Breyer, my colleague, says. Your body isn't just a brain taxi. It's not just a thing that gets you around. If it was just engineering, you'd all be sitting on the chairs in the same way. Yeah? If I would be standing with the middle of my foot beneath my hip socket like this. Nobody stands like this. Stand like this. Yeah? Now that's not structural, that's not engineering. It makes no sense to stand like this from an engineering point of view, with your feet together, for example, your legs crossed. But that might make sense from a cultural point of view, from a feminist analysis of embodiment, from an analysis of who you are and how you don't like to take up space, for example. That might make a lot of sense. Yeah? So the body as part of how we think, how we perceive, how we relate. You know, if this is my embodiment, there's going to be a way you can relate to me compared to this. Everyone tilt their head to the side. Say ah. Okay, some of you feels weird as shit and really want to get out of it. Others are going, well, I was sort of there anyway. The nice people are like, yes, Mark, I'll do that, that's no problem. Okay, increase your blink rate a little bit. Breathe, soften your belly. Say ah. Yeah. Some of you hate this. And the reason you hate it is because you've built an entire way of being from your childhood which says that this is not the way to find safe love and belonging. Okay, now put your head on straight. Put your feet and your knees a bit wider if you're not wearing too short skirt. Find your solid ground. Take up a bit more space without sort of elbowing the people next to you too much. And again, some of you didn't have to move, did you? Because some of you were already sitting that way because it's your habit, it's your... Stuart Heller calls this the bureaucracy of habit, where when you look at me or anyone else, you see history. You see my alcoholic dad. You see my friend who killed herself. You see, this hand is not just an object. This hand has held my niece when she was born. When she was born sick, and we kind of held on. We said, it's going to be okay. Your mum's here, Uncle Marty, it's going to be okay. We've got you. And she didn't, logically, she couldn't understand English, but she felt that holding, yeah? This hand punched out my dad and he came in drunk when I was, 12, 13? Yeah? This hand has been part of my life. So when you look at all of me, you're looking at history. Does it make sense? You're not just looking at me. Whew. So much more than body language, body being, how we are as people. Body is I, not it. That's the kind of key message here. After the break, we'll look at some experiential ways to look at that. But again, we're really just talking about being human. The consequence here, the last thing I'll say here is, I work in Russia a lot. I work in gay community in Russia quite a lot. That's my sort of charity work while I'm out there. Yeah. And they gave me a lesbian translator after the one I married. I thought they'd make the next one safe, so they gave me a lesbian translator. So I ended up becoming good friends with her, and she took me on all these projects. We started working around trauma and stress with people. And we did this project, it was a few months long, and I said, you know, with my translator, I said, what did you get from this project? So I was expecting these gay people to say, you know, to stress management or to be a better leader in the gay community. And one of them said, it helped me assert my right to be. A right to be. That was the key takeaway she had. So that's what we're really looking at here, your being. Yeah, your being under conditions, joyful and difficult. Cup of tea? Thank you.